like everything is new.
I turned the door handle and pushed, but the door wouldn't budge. I tried again, but no luck. I came up when I was out of breath. Obviously, the boat had sunk. The door wouldn't open because the cabin was probably full of water. I was still alive, and I wasn't giving up. But what about Julie? Until that moment, I hadn't cried, but now I started sobbing and couldn't stop. Meanwhile, the water had risen more. What's worse, taking deep breaths while crying had used up a lot of oxygen, and I could feel there wasn't much of it left. I was in such bad shape that I couldn't tell how much time had passed. The water was now up to my chin. I was cold, I was hungry, I was thirsty, I was tired, and very sleepy. For a moment, I thought, let yourself go and let it all end. As a medical student, I was aware that it was hypothermia that made me think like this. I had been in cold water for a long time, so my body temperature had fallen, and it was going to continue to fall. I was losing hope that help would come. We weren't in open water, but who would look for us? Neither my parents nor Julie's knew that we were here. Would Ethan's family do something? I didn't think so. I thought this was the end for me. The water continued to rise slowly. It got so high that I had to stand on my toes to avoid drowning. Just then, I heard a sound. It was like someone had hit something a few times. I held my breath. The sound stopped. Maybe there was no sound. Maybe I was hallucinating because I was about to pass out. No! I heard the sound again, and this time it was closer. Anyways, if I was hallucinating, I would have heard my mom's voice or something. Why would I hear the sound of metal being hit? I dived into the water one more time. There was a soap dish made of stone. I grabbed it and came back up. I started hitting the wall with it. The other sound stopped. All you could hear was me hitting the wall. I stopped after a while. Then the sound from the outside started again. I was communicating with someone. They knew I was here. They turned out to be two divers from the search and rescue team. At first, they couldn't open the door because of the pressure. But they were there to save me. After a while, they managed to get me out of the bathroom and then out of the boat. There were doctors on the search and rescue ship. They had a lot of experience with such situations and were able to help me recover from hypothermia. As soon as I was feeling better, I asked about Julie. I found out that both she and Ethan were okay. Apparently, Ethan had diabetes, but he was too drunk to take his insulin shot. Diabetes patients lose consciousness in such situations and go into a coma after a while. Ethan somehow got himself to our cabin door and knocked. Julie helped him right away. She gave him his insulin shot, but he was still feeling very bad. Just then, the storm broke out, so he had no choice but to go upstairs. Julie went up with him too. Thankfully, she thought of putting on their life jackets. Ethan managed to start the engine, but the waves were too big and he couldn't prevent the boat from drifting. They fell into the water when the boat hit the rocks. Julie never left Ethan's side. The waves washed both of them onto the beach. Ethan had lost consciousness, so Julie couldn't leave him. The next day, a group of hikers accidentally came across them. They are both doing well now. After hearing this story, my first reaction was, they'll definitely get married after going through this together. After a horrific 36 hours, I managed to come back to life. I think I did pretty well overall. Of course, I got very lucky, but deciding to go into the bathroom, managing to stay calm, fighting the hypothermia, I definitely deserve a well done. Thanks for listening to my story. If you like stories like this, subscribe to this channel. Bye.